Good evening, everyone. Will Rosenzweig here. Thanks for the compliments on my homemade mask. And thanks for those of you that are modeling them at home. As you may know, we now have not only a shelter in place order, but we have a mask in public areas order. So we were busy here at home all weekend, mass producing homemade masks from leftover fabric. It's a pretty fun thing to do. If you need patterns, you can find them on the internet. This one, this particular one, was on the Kaiser Permanente website. And it takes about, the first one takes a long time, but after that it gets a little bit easier. But since I'm alone in my office here, I think I will forego the mask during class, as you can as well, unless you're very close to another classmate watching this tonight. Well, thank you so much for being here. This is yet another meeting of Edible Ed, and tonight's class meeting is really an example of an agile class formation and teaching. We had originally scheduled tonight to be focused on food access and food sovereignty, and it turned out that all of the guests who we invited are so busy on the front lines of feeding people right now that they begged our forgiveness and asked to step out. So we are so lucky and fortunate to have one of our true outstanding thought leaders in the field, Anna LaPay, with us tonight. And this class is going to be led by our very talented graduate student instructor, Fiona McBride. And I'll just get us started with my normal poll and introduction. I wanted to share with you, let's see, I'm going to, you know, our motto here has been be bamboo, right? To be strongly rooted. Let's see if I can share my screen. Oh, will that picture please show up? My computer. Well, bamboo, I've been working with the bamboo this week, and bamboo grows very dramatically at this time of year, and I have a picture to show you that's not loading, so I forgive me for that. But this picture will show you that the bamboo not only grows vertically, but it also grows horizontally. And this is a root that connects to a whole network and family of roots. And so one of the reasons bamboo is so strong and deeply rooted is that it's connected. It's connected to a whole network and community of other rhizomes that then produce shoots. And as you know, the bamboo is a grass. It's a form of a grass. So I just wanted to point that out to you, that one of the reasons it's so strong and it's such a great metaphor for our work together is that it's connected. It's connected to itself and other things. So tonight, again, just wanted to remind the students that you needed to register with your Berkeley email so that you'll get credit for attendance. You'll need to participate in the attendance poll, which is going to come up in a little while. If you want to enjoy this and see the speaker, you can use side-by-side mode. But actually, I don't think we're going to really have a lot of slides tonight, maybe one or two. Ask your questions to Anna and Fiona in the chat. We're going to have a really fun breakout tonight where we're going to experiment with a new tool where in small groups we're going to generate ideas in a Google slide document that we're then going to share. And we're going to bookend our breakout with question and answer and our attendance. And then I have a little special surprise for you for the wrap up to chart the path forward for the remaining meetings of the class. So just as a warm up, let's proliferate our chat box with answers to this question. What food-related habit or behavior will you carry into your post-pandemic life? So I think for me, I'll just give you a cue. I think for me, it's going to be about wasting less food. What about you? Growing foods, smoothies, cooking more, sourdough, cooking, 50 shades of beets. Wow, this is fabulous. Fiona, we might have to share this on the Berkeleyan newspaper.
Yeah.
This is great. Thank you all. It's fantastic.
Banana bread, important.
And crisp apples. Three meals a day versus snacking. Oh, that sounds positive. Eating in moderation. All right, now let's go. I'm going to stop sharing my screen and I'm going to take you over to the poll. Let's see if I do this. And share with you the first poll here. So this is about what food system disruptions have you experienced? And the second question is about what food experience do you miss most during the pandemic? And we've got 140 out of 200 people responding. Most people, looks like the majority of people have not had too many disruptions. I'm going to share the poll with you in a few minutes. And it seems like what people are missing most are eating with friends and family and being able to freely shop at the market anytime and eating out. That would make sense. Okay, I'm going to end the poll and I'm going to share the results with you so you can see. That's great. That should be helpful in our discussion tonight as well. Okay, I'm going to turn it over to you, Fiona. Fiona McBride, our graduate student instructor, and I am going to pin your video and have you take over.
Sounds good. Hi, everyone. So as Will mentioned, tonight's class was originally going to be focused on food access, sovereignty, and ownership. And obviously, these are critical issues that are coming up even more during this pandemic. And we're definitely going to dive into them tonight. But it's kind of exciting. We're going to have an even more comprehensive discussion around the pandemic's impact on the food system, thanks to our guest, Anna LaPay. And I'm thrilled to have Anna here. I've been a longtime fan. I first saw Anna speak in New York at an event a number of years ago. And she brings such a depth of experience and a really motivating lens to all things food. So I'm thrilled that you guys will be here to listen to her tonight. I did want to take a minute to review the speakers who are going to join us tonight and encourage you to learn more online. So originally we were going to have Shakira Simley moderating this event. She's the director of the Office of Racial Equity in San Francisco. And she's had a really amazing career in food justice and has been appointed to ensure that the emergency response effort in San Francisco is being equitably deployed, essentially, which is incredibly important. Geetika Akral is the program director at La Cocina, and she that's an organization that works on supporting small-scale food entrepreneurs. And they're doing all sorts of work right now to support those workers who have had an 80 to 100% decrease in their business. And there's an emergency relief fund that you can learn more about online if you're interested in helping out. And then Carly Brinkman, who's the food and farming director at the Ecology Center. They have done amazing work in the Bay Area on food access, specifically at farmers markets. And as many of you may know, farmers markets remain an essential service, an important point for food access right now. And so they're incredibly busy changing their operating models to work during pandemic times. And then we have Bram Ahmadi, the founder and CEO of Community Foods Market in West Oakland, which has an amazing community-based model for ownership that kind of goes beyond just basic tenets of food access. Their store is really busy right now, also adapting. And then finally, Ciara Segura, the Director of Programs and Policy at Mandela Partners. And they're really pivoting their programs right now to emergency relief. So I'm sorry that you guys won't have access to these speakers tonight, but I think for me, I'm also just so grateful that they're out there in the field getting food to the people who need it most. I also wanted to just let you know that if you're interested in supporting any of their emergency efforts, to please reach out to me after the class and I can send you resources of what they're doing. But I think, you know, one of the major questions we are going to explore tonight anyway is this idea of community resiliency, right? At the heart of food access, and especially the type of access that deals with sovereignty and ownership, is this idea of cultivating communities that are strong and independent, especially when it comes to food systems. And so I think this idea is even more relevant tonight as we talk about food systems in the time of COVID. With that in mind, I'm excited to introduce Anna LaPay. She's, it's kind of a big silver lining that we get to have her here tonight. And I'm just gonna give you a brief intro of some of her experience in the food system. So Anna is a national best-selling author and an internationally recognized expert on food systems. She's the author of 3 books, including Diet for a Hot Planet, and a contributing author to 11 more. With her mother, Frances Moore LaPay, she's also a founder of the Small Planet Institute and Fund, which has raised and given away more than $1 million to grassroots organizations worldwide since its founding in 2002. 2 of those organizations have won Nobel Peace Prizes, no big deal. She currently leads Real Food Media, an amazing organization, also happens to be a beautiful website. And it's a collaborative initiative working with partners around the country to bust myths and spark conversations about our food system, catalyzing creative storytelling and connecting communities for action. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Anna to lead us in a conversation about food systems under COVID. And as Will said, please post questions in the chat box, and then I'll be collecting those as we go, and then we'll talk about those once Anna's done with her presentation. So Anna, go ahead and take it away.
Great. Thank you so much, Fiona. Can I just see a wave of hands or thumbs up if you all can hear me? Yes. Okay. Awesome. Good. I have to say, when all your images came up in gallery view, it was really emotional for me to see all of you all sheltered in place in all the many places that you must be home in. And I also was reflecting on all of my, almost all of my video Zoom calls lately have been with second graders and fifth graders, as my 2 daughters have been sheltering in place and home from school. And so this is a little bit of a different Zoom for me. It is really a pleasure to be back at Edible Education. I have really enjoyed every time I've gotten to interact with the students and the leaders of the program. And as Fiona was saying, the amazing colleagues and friends of mine who were slated to speak tonight are clearly on the front lines of this crisis. So I was really happy to be able to step in and to be able to tonight share with you some thoughts about the impacts of this crisis on farmers, food workers, and really all of us, and what I am seeing about how this crisis is revealing some of the vulnerabilities of our current food system and ways that we can build back a food system that really works for all of us. But I wanted to just start this evening to just share a little bit of my bias, which is that I have a firm belief that our food systems, both in the US and around the world, should and could foster thriving communities and healthy people, dignity for everyone, including food workers, and should work in harmony with nature to preserve biodiversity and to create climate stability. And so much of the work that I've done over the last two decades has been in partnership with folks around the world to try to work toward a vision that really is about a food system that reflects those values. I will also say that particularly over the last few weeks as this crisis has been unfolding here in the US, I have been really impacted by seeing the work that my husband and his colleagues have been doing in organized labor. He works for a union called the United Food and Commercial Workers, and they represent grocery retail workers and also other retail workers and some other workers across the economy. And to just hear through him how much these workers are obviously so vital to all of us and how much they're being so impacted by this crisis has been a huge part of my experience of this crisis so far. So as I said, I've been reflecting about what this crisis reveals about the weaknesses in our global industrial food system and what it's showing about the benefits of a nature-aligned, more sustainable one, and how we as a global community can and are stepping up to protect vulnerable populations and ecosystems at this time. What I want to share tonight really comes from weeks of absorbing lessons being learned and work being done by colleagues around the country and the world, attending briefings among food system leaders nationwide that are in rapid response to this crisis, and having one-on-one conversations with partners in philanthropy. I work partly for a family foundation doing grant making in the field, and so I've been talking to a lot of people in philanthropy about how philanthropy can play a role in responding to the crisis. And so what I'm sharing comes from all of that. It comes from really thinking about how this crisis is already impacting food systems and what groups are doing to ensure a response that actually strengthens communities and ecological food producers. What I'm going to share with you tonight is really three big things, sort of Cliff Notes version of some thoughts. First, how COVID-19 is impacting the food system. And second, what I see as some of the biggest threats and opportunities of this moment. And then third, what we're starting to see about how people are stepping up and responding and organizing. In fact, many of the folks who are going to be on this call and part of this class this evening, I'm going to share some of the ways that they have been stepping up and responding. So first, what are we already seeing about how COVID-19 is impacting the food systems? I want to talk about four key areas, and I want to start with food workers. So as many of you may know, there are 22 million people working along the food chain, including farm workers, food prep and delivery, and food retail workers. Some of you might work or have worked in the food system. And as we know, these are workers who really are on the front lines and in many cases now actually risking their lives to keep putting food on our tables. These are workers who already were among the most vulnerable and exploited in our economy. Many of these jobs had no paid sick leave, no or little health insurance, and very poor wages, conditions of which have only worsened during this crisis. 7 million tipped workers have already lost their jobs, and that's a figure from last week and a half, so it's probably even higher today, largely a result of the restaurant industry collapsing, as you can imagine. The crisis is exposing the inequality and injustices that were already here in our food system, embedded in the very structures of this part of our economy, and we are seeing how they're exacerbating them every day. So I want to take a moment to raise up the vulnerability in particular of the 2 to 3 million farm workers in the US. They're particularly vulnerable because, as you may know, farm workers are one of the few classes of worker that are exempt from both the minimum wage and overtime pay provisions in the Fair Labor Standards Act. They're also at greater risk because they toil in the fields where air quality is terrible, where they're exposed to pesticides and other air pollutants that make their lungs that much more vulnerable to COVID-19. I encourage those of you who might not have seen it yet to read in today's New York Times a really powerful op-ed from a farm worker in the Northeast, a member of a national organization called the Food Chain Workers Alliance, a membership coalition of 33 organizations representing 375,000 workers across the food chain nationwide. And this farm worker described how her employer is putting her and her coworkers at risk. She described the policy in place that where her employer would withhold pay if they stayed home sick, and that if she or her coworkers take too many days off, they actually lose points, and that leads to deductions in what is already a very small annual bonus. And so she talked about how farm workers are continuing to work even when they are symptomatic and when they're sick or injured. And she mentioned how, thanks to advocacy prior to COVID-19 by groups like the Food Chain Workers Alliance, there were some additional benefits to farm workers put in place in the past few years in New York State, but those are certainly not nationwide, and they are certainly not enough. And it doesn't seem like it is getting any better. You may have seen the recent news that came out in the past week that the White House Chief of Staff, Mark Meadows, was working with USDA Secretary to explore how to actually reduce the wages of foreign guest workers on farms, as if they weren't low enough already, workers that are the backbone of the workforce on many U.S. farms. So I mentioned the Food Chain Workers Alliance. It is one of the many organizations that are really flexing their advocacy muscles right now to call for stimulus funds that would address these concerns, particularly about farm workers, but about all food workers, and have been developing a bunch of rapid response actions, including calling for paid sick leave and other policies that would protect those workers who are now really on the front lines. So the second category I want to talk about, what we're already seeing a huge impact, is of course on everyday eaters. I mean, in the poll, you all said that your food life hasn't been so disrupted, but as you can imagine, many people around the country who were food insecure before this crisis, many families whose children were relying on school feeding programs for the majority of their calories have been hugely impacted. And we're seeing that as schools and universities close for an indefinite period of time, it's those communities that were most dependent on those institutions for their food that are being hugely impacted. 22 million students across the country qualify for free or reduced price meals. Those are 22 million kids that relied on those meals as the main source of their nutrition typically. In addition, there's about 40 million Americans who were already struggling with food security before this crisis, and with unemployment rate ranks increasing, we know that number is going to go up as well. And so we had already seen for a very long time, maybe you've heard about it in edible education, we've already seen many networks across the country emerging to work with school districts and universities and colleges to rethink food procurement, to bring more healthy farm fresh food into those institutions, and to support farmers using sustainable practices. And so those networks are all now in high gear, really shifting their policies and practices to think about how do they respond to this disruption in the supply chain and the disruption of these former hubs, these schools and universities going away. How do you respond to that to create new systems? So groups like the Center for Good Food Purchasing, Food Corps, Real Food Generation, to name a few, are groups that are really working hard to shore up school districts' feeding programs and also to engage in advocacy to ensure strong procurement policy for good food in these stimulus packages. So the third category I want to talk about, and then I'll move on to the fourth and last. The third category, which none of these should surprise any of you, who is being the most impacted, farmers and ranchers. So already, again, if you're in this class, you probably know this quite well, already in this country, most farmers and ranchers work on razor-thin margins. Most farmers in this country need off-farm income to make their lives economically sustainable. And so we're already seeing what a devastating blow this crisis is to farmers. They're feeling immediate impacts, particularly as they are losing stable buyers like those schools and universities that I talked about. One of the groups that the foundation where I work supports is called the National Sustainable Agriculture Coalition. It has members across the country. Its members reported a $750 million decline in on-farm sales from March to May. And what we're seeing is a hugely disproportionate impact on which farmers are being the most impacted. So farmers of color, young farmers, farmers using sustainable practices, smaller scale farmers, those that already lack long-term land tenure and access to capital, those are the farmers that are being the most impacted already by this crisis. And so while we are seeing demand shoot up, as you and I, we saw it in the poll, you and I are eating a lot more food at home, of course, due to what we're seeing is that due to how consolidated our food economy was before this crisis, that we're not seeing that demand translate to the food producers who need it most, and I would argue most deserve it. And instead, those that, again, the largest players in the sector are able to capture the most of this market share. And the concern is that coming out of this crisis, that land ownership and farming will only be more concentrated as those with the most resources are best able to weather this crisis and access those federal stimulus dollars. We're seeing that that you might have seen this in the news. We're seeing stories of farmers who, unable to access those former markets, are actually dumping milk or plowing under their produce, again, despite, of course, the huge demand that's out there. One particular community of food producers I want to raise up are those that get food from the sea, so the fisher folk and folks that work in the seafood industry. It's a $100 billion annual industry in this country, but 70% of seafood consumption happens in restaurants with us dining out. So as we are sheltering in place and as restaurants have been devastated, that whole part of the food economy has been one of the most impacted sectors of the economy. As I mentioned, groups have been working to look at the stimulus funds and look at what funds are going to farmers and how do we make sure that those funds are going to the farmers who most need it, including those small-scale farmers, including those who work, those who live and work in fishing communities. So the fourth and final area that I want to talk about, the area of the food economy that's been so impacted, has been restaurants, of course. Hospitality industry, devastated. But in the process of seeing this devastation unfold, I think what we're seeing is a real clarity about the role that restaurants play in the food chain, and particularly in the food chain for kind of the good food that we've been talking about, so farmers that are using sustainable practices. And that is that restaurants that have embraced the farm-to-table movement, that have really work to connect directly to farmers. They have provided, and they were providing, a high-end buyer for farmers using some of the best sustainable practices out there, providing much-needed capital to then enable many of those same farmers to sell at lower prices into community markets, into institutional markets like schools, and also into sometimes even give away food into food recovery networks to supply those in most need of healthy farm fresh food. So as the restaurant industry is collapsing as we speak, those farmers who had those restaurants as this really stable buyer have been really impacted. The restaurant industry brings in about $1 trillion a year into the US economy. And as a recent piece in the New York Times talked about a few weeks ago, that without really targeted federal investment in the sector, particularly in mom and pop restaurants, that 75% of small and independent restaurants could be shuttered as a result of this crisis and could really have a hard time ever being reborn. What we're seeing is networks of advocates, some new networks and some networks that have been around for a long time, come together really quickly in the past few weeks to, again, work to advocate for a stimulus package that would ensure that some of those smallest restaurants, the smaller scale restaurants, those mom and pop restaurants can survive this crisis. So those were four of main categories. And again, I wouldn't expect that any of that would surprise any of you, but I think it's helpful to kind of lift them up and to articulate how these aspects of the food economy have already been so affected. And we're really just entering into to this new era, into this crisis. So I want to move now to talk about what I and others that I've been talking with see as threats and opportunities. And I don't know if you've ever seen any motivational speaker talk about crisis and use the line that in Chinese, the character for crisis is composed of two Chinese characters signifying danger and opportunity. And I've always thought it was a real cliche, you know, to say, oh, well, you know, a crisis is really just an opportunity in disguise. And it really is a cliche, but it is also true that crises do create incredible opportunities. But just as critically, they are also moments that present huge threats, never before seen threats. And So I want to raise up some of the opportunities I'm seeing. I want to raise up some of the threats I'm seeing. There are many more opportunities and threats, and we'll prompt all of you to, in your smaller groups, kind of reflect on some of the opportunities and threats that I'm about to share with you, and then also some of the additional ones that you may already be seeing. So first, I think there's a huge opportunity here for us to use this crisis to help more people see how vital are food workers, farm workers, and farmers. You know, to really see how vital these people are to our economy, to our well-being, to our public health, and therefore to inspire more people to fight for policies that will outlive this crisis and ensure the kinds of working conditions that our partners have long advocated for and that workers deserve. Second, I think there is a huge opportunity for people to have this crisis, again, kind of help to wake up in people's consciousness the need to invest in regional food systems. As this crisis is revealing the fragility of industrial, of a global industrial system with many steps between consumer and producer. Third, I think there is an opportunity to underscore here the importance of public health tied to healthy food, emphasizing the need to invest in healthy food and emergency food distribution networks, and also in public purchasing like school food programs, that and those investments are investments vital to public health. And finally, I think there is a huge opportunity to have this crisis be a moment to help communicate why more sustainable food systems are necessary, why these nature-based sustainable food systems are essential to protecting biodiversity, health, and the climate, and also we use this crisis as a teaching tool to show how destructive industrial agriculture has been on ecosystems worldwide, to use it as a moment to remind people that it is industrial agriculture that is behind about 80% of deforestation worldwide, that on nearly every continent, land grabs by agribusiness have pushed small farmers onto increasingly marginal land, that indigenous communities have been pushed off of ecosystems they've long stewarded by agribusiness, that these dynamics we have known for a long time have brought wild animal populations, natural hosts for pathogens, into closer contact with humans, to help people see how scientists have long warned us that it would only be a matter of time before these pathogens would find new hosts, us, and how indeed evolutionary biologists and epidemiologists suggest that the industrial food system has helped create the structural conditions for this outbreak, for ones that have come before, for ones that will come after, and that this crisis can be a powerful reminder of one of the ways that our industrial food system puts us at risk. So those are four of the opportunities that I see. But there are, of course, massive threats. And if there was a word even more massive than massive, I would use it. And I'm just going to share a couple of those. So first, we're already seeing how the food industry is exploiting this crisis to call for even more industrialization of the food chain, more artificial intelligence and robotics to reduce human labor in the supply chain, more genetic engineering and lab-grown foods to reduce the intersection between nature and food production, all with untold risk for health, workers, and the environment. Second, we're already seeing how the Trump administration is using this crisis to give more leniency to corporate polluters. The administration used COVID-19 as an excuse most recently to roll back all Environmental Protection Agency environmental regulations with huge implications for public health broadly and farmer and farm worker health specifically. We're also seeing similar rollbacks now happening across our food safety and food inspection systems. Third, as those corporations with the most power and market share are best positioned to advocate for federal stimulus money and to access it, we stand to see even more consolidated markets coming out of this crisis. We saw an example of this in reporting just this week from Politico. Some of you may have seen Congress approved $350 billion for something called the Paycheck Protection Program. And it was targeted loans to businesses with fewer than 500 employers. But you But Congress gave larger restaurants and hotel operators flexibility to access those funds as well. And in reporting from Politico, we're seeing emerging evidence that really large companies, huge restaurant chains, have been best able to tap that first wave of loans coming out of the Paycheck Protection Program. So what we're seeing is that it's the largest factory farms, the largest food corporations that have the most ability to weather this crisis, and that without interventions, it will be those biggest farms, biggest businesses and restaurant chains that could be among the only ones left standing when we emerge out of this crisis. That is a huge, huge threat as I see it. So how are groups responding to these threats and taking advantage of these opportunities? So I want to just share three things in closing here. And of course, there's so much happening. It's happening so fast, and there's so much work being done. It's been really inspiring for me to see. So first, groups are fighting for a just stimulus. They were fighting for just stimulus packages that have preceded the one that just came out, and they're fighting for just stimulus packages that will come next. This last stimulus package, which was dubbed C3, the National Sustainable Agriculture Coalition, among many other partners, mobilized and advocated and lobbied to ensure that there was aid for farmers and that there was policies that helped food insecure people. And there were some wins, but there were also big disappointments. So for instance, while Congress approved $15 billion in C3 and $9 billion in C2, the previous stimulus package for childhood nutrition programs, it's important to underscore that those dollars, which are a lot for sure, those dollars don't go to any additional person getting benefits from that money, that it's just funding the current caseloads of people that are on food assistance. And so as advocates look towards C4 and additional stimulus packages, they're looking to actually, how do we get more assistance to those who are food insecure in this moment? In the C3 package, again, for another example, $9.5 billion was earmarked for farmers. And that was only because advocates fought for it. But now groups are pushing to create kind of guardrails around that $9.5 billion to ensure that it actually makes it to farmers and to people in rural communities who need it most. If not, you know, that $9.5 billion could go to some of the worst polluting factory farms and not to the farmers that are engaging in the practices that are best for us eaters and best for the planet. So secondly, we're seeing incredible advocacy by groups around the country, by labor unions like the United Food and Commercial Workers, to advocate for food workers' health and safety. For Congress to do more to support newly unemployed food and farm workers by expanding, for instance, the number of weeks that workers are eligible for unemployment, regardless of immigration status, which is particularly important among food workers, and also to provide hazard pay. They're also advocating to ensure that all food and farm workers are designated as first responders, which would make them eligible to receive state benefits such as childcare, overtime, premium pay, and the right to organize. And really, these advocates are working to ensure that these stimulus packages help everyday working people, that it's not just a corporate bailout with no conditionalities, and to really ensure that as we see these next stimulus packages come through Congress, that they will be even stronger. And third and finally, what we're seeing is incredible creativity in food supply chains. So schools developing home meal kits and delivery systems to get food to those families that relied on those programs before the schools closed. For restaurants to move to food delivery or to takeout. For farmers to partner with food banks. And for advocates like Carly Brinkman, who is going to be on with you tonight, and others who advocated to ensure that farmers markets could stay open as other business were forced to close during these shelter-in-place orders. So those are just a couple examples of how people are really trying to creatively rethink food supply chains in this moment. So I have shared with you a lot. I know I talk very fast for Zoom, so my apologies, but I hope I gave you some hints at how we're seeing COVID-19 already affecting so many players in the food system, what we're seeing as some of the threats and opportunities about this crisis, and some of the ways that groups around the country and the world are already responding. As I close out and move to the next portion of our class together, I want to read some words to you from the Indian novelist Arundhati Roy, from an op-ed that she wrote recently in the Financial Times. So she wrote, "Historically, pandemics have forced humans to break with the past and imagine their world anew. This one is no different. It is a portal, a gateway between one world and the next. We can choose to walk through it, dragging the carcasses of our prejudice and hatred, our avarice, our data banks and dead ideas, our dead rivers and smoky skies behind us. Or we can walk through it lightly, with little luggage, ready to imagine another world and ready to fight for it." So thank you all for joining me tonight as the sun sets here in Berkeley, and I look forward to engaging with you for the rest of the class.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Anna. I think that was a great presentation, and I know for me at least, currently all the news and food systems news is just kind of overwhelming, and we see the impacts on pretty much every layer of the food system, and so it's just really helpful to have, I think, this framework for understanding how to think about it and where the different levers are, both in terms of what you're talking about, of like the devastation that we're seeing, but also the opportunities to help. And so we have a bunch of questions from students. I wanted to kick off with one question that I had, and then we'll get into some of the questions from students. So I read this really interesting piece from Tunde Wei, who's a New Orleans-based chef recently. He wrote this piece about the restaurant industry titled "Let It Die." I'm going to read a short quote from him. He says, "An industry where labor is segregated by race and gender, underpaid and uninsured, an industry fed largely by an industrial agricultural system that either extracts profits from the environment with little consequences or offers ethically sourced produce to just a few for a lot, let it die." And so I thought that was a really powerful quote and overall piece, and kind of brings up this question that you talked about with this ending quote of not just kind of what we're doing to immediately respond to the crisis and help people who are in real distress, which is incredibly important, but also what is the impact of this on the food system going forward. And so I'd love to hear kind of some of your thoughts, maybe if you want to focus on the restaurant industry, just to narrow the question of what do you think this is going to look like for changing the restaurant industry long term? And I've seen some, I think, you know, a lot of these campaigns like One Fair Wage is doing both. They're organizing for immediate support and long-term efforts, but I think the students would love to hear more about your thoughts on that.
Let it die and let it be reborn. I mean, I think what Tunde Wei is getting at, and others like Sarah Jayaraman, who has had a long association with edible education and who was a co-founder of Restaurants Opportunity Center and has recently spun out a new organization called One Fair Wage. What folks like Saru emphasize again and again in the midst of this crisis is the system wasn't working before. The system was not working before when you have a restaurant industry reliant on the labor of workers who are in the tipped wage category of worker, where they're getting $2.13 an hour. That is a vestige, as Saru emphasizes every time she talks about it, of slavery. It is racist, it is fundamentally unjust, and it needs to go into the dustbin of history. With many things that have been so problematic about the way our economy functions for workers. And so I think that, you know, there is an opportunity for leaders like Sarah Jayaraman, who's been really out on front on this issue, to again take this as a moment to say, you know, these restaurants are going under. We should be building them back, but we should be building them back with different economic structures so that you don't have workers in the restaurant industry that are getting $2.13 as a tipped wage, that you have, as she puts it, as her new organization is called, One Fair Wage, where you don't have what she showcased in her book, Behind the Kitchen Door, of literally racial segregation across the kitchen. She and co-authors of that book and other reports in the restaurant industry would showed irrefutably that there is actually a racial hierarchy in restaurants, that the front of the house workers tend to be whiter, the back of the house down to the dishwashers tend to be darker, more undocumented immigrants. And we should let that aspect of the restaurant industry die. What we should give birth to, though, is a restaurant industry that is built in based out of values of, again, worker well-being and of a real honoring of the relationship between the restaurant and the farmer.
Great, thank you. Yeah, and I'm excited to see, I mean, I was sad to see, for instance, like Reams, which is a wonderful restaurant in Fruitvale closing down temporarily, but I think I'm hoping we'll see some amazing new models develop out of this this crisis. So I wanna give you a question from a student now. Miranda asks, when it comes to how restaurants and farmers are impacted, is it equally widespread across the country, or are there specific geographic areas where these businesses and people are more greatly impacted?
That is a great question, and I wish in my COVID-19 brain, I have these facts, I would have these facts at my fingertips, but I don't. But I can tell you in broad strokes that the food production in this country is highly unequal across the states. So, you know, here in California, there are some products, you know, broccoli or asparagus, where we are, you know, almost 100% of the market. So there are certain products that are heavily landed in certain states, and then there's certain states that are home to disproportionate number of animal factory farms. So Iowa, North Carolina, states that became the site of huge expansion of factory farms, not because of any natural selection of those states being better suited for such production, but actually because of very weak labor standards and environmental standards that allowed those operations to really take root in those places. So certain places are more impacted for different reasons. And I would say that, again, kind of like the previous question about restaurants, look, farmers in this country were struggling before this crisis. Before this crisis, dairy farmers were in a crisis on par with the crisis from the 80s. We are seeing a huge spike in farmer suicides. So again, it's not as if we started from a place where we had a food system that was working well. We had a food system where, if you look at the research from the U.S. Department of Agriculture, you know, less than 10 cents of every dollar you and I spend on food was going back to the food producers, who I would argue are most responsible for getting that food to our plates. So again, it's another way in which, of course, those farmers are of course, being the most impacted by this crisis, but already they were in a position to be so vulnerable because there was so much that was broken about the system to start with.
Thank you for that. So I wanted to turn a little bit to this question of food access. And I was able to attend the Policy School's annual Race and Policy Symposium last week, and they had a wonderful keynote talking about some overlaps between housing and food and other issues during crisis. And one of the speakers spoke about this idea of inequality and inequity almost being a comorbidity now, or sorry, not almost being a comorbidity from a public health standpoint. And we're seeing that happen now as numbers are coming out showing that especially Black people are dying at disproportionate rates to other racial groups in the US as a result of the crisis. And so, you know, this has been something people have talked about a long time in terms of the obesity epidemic, type 2 diabetes, but I'd be curious to hear your thoughts about how that might be exaggerated during this time of crisis.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'd be happy to pull it and drop it into these chat notes to share it. There was a map that the Times created of mapping where they were seeing the most number of cases and the most deaths related to COVID-19 across all the boroughs. And I was sharing it with a colleague of mine that works for an agency for the city of New York that houses housing insecure people and provides food to them. And she was talking about the neighborhoods in which she works, and she was looking at these maps, and she's like, that's a map of income, that's a map of race, that's a map of COVID. You layer them on top of themselves and it's the same map. And we've seen this again and again. Probably one of the best academic books about this comorbidity between race and inequality was from a sociologist, I think the book was called Heat Wave, about the heat wave in Chicago and how it disproportionately affected people of color and low-income people who disproportionately died as a result of this heat wave. But again, this is what we know to be true, what we knew to be true before COVID-19. You could look at a zip code and you could predict life expectancy. I remember for a talk I was giving a few years back, in Santa Cruz, I was looking at a map of Salinas Valley and the zip code for Salinas Valley, which is home to farm workers, and the zip code for Carmel, you know, a really high-end coastal community. And I don't remember off the top of my head what the life expectancy differences were, but I want to say on the order of magnitude of like 15 or 20 years. And so again, this is a story that we knew to be true before COVID-19, and COVID-19 is making it even more transparent. I think it's also an expression of a very broken healthcare system, a healthcare system that was tied to employment. When you have millions of people going onto unemployment, a healthcare system that really didn't work for most people in this country and put those who have the least access to social capital and who are the poorest, who are most harmed by it.
Yeah, thank you. And I think, one thing I've been thinking about as what I hope will be a silver lining, at least in California, where I'm more familiar with local policy, one example that's been exciting in terms of food access is kind of lowering restrictions for access to things like food stamps. So, getting rid of the interview requirements, mm-hmm. not possible during shelter in place.
Like Mike Bloomberg did, he used to require fingerprinting.
Exactly, which mm-hmm. has a whole host of other problems. Mm-hmm. Making re-enrollment automatic. Often people drop off SNAP accidentally because they forgot to re-enroll, and that can be a pretty burdensome process. And so I think that it's potentially exciting in terms of hopefully Governor Newsom having an eye towards policies that aren't just reactions to this crisis, but could be in place long term. And it certainly gives advocates some information to argue for these policies to continue once we see that these decisions can be more easily made by policymakers than they might have suggested.
Right. Yeah, and I want to say something about SNAP, and then I also, for those of you who want to go deeper on what this theme we were just talking about health and inequality, the book that I recommend, it's called Heat Wave, A Social Autopsy of Disaster in Chicago, and it's by a sociologist named Eric Kleinenberg. Some of you may have already read it, particularly those in the public health school. I think that's a great, what you just shared, Fiona, is a great example of how this crisis could kick in some new systems. I mean, look, the conversation about Medicare for All had started before COVID-19, but I feel like this moment is making the call for that much more clear. Around SNAP, which is what food nutrition, food assistance is called now, formerly known as food stamps, the other thing we're seeing and that I see as another example of how without advocacy, this crisis will consolidate power in the food chain is that right now, the only companies who have the back-end capability of accepting SNAP for online food purchases are Walmart and Amazon. And even that has been only piloted in a few states. But imagine online ability for SNAP recipients to shop. It rolls out across all 50 states. At the moment, the only two retailers who would benefit from all of those sales and all the profit associated with those sales would be Walmart and Amazon, potentially really hurting most those grocery stores that exist, the brick and mortar grocery stores in the neighborhoods where those people who are compromised with food insecurity live and work. So coming out of this crisis have even less resources to get back on their feet.
Yeah, thank you. And just in reference to the book you mentioned, I'll try to kind of pull together these resources that are being mentioned tonight and send them out in an email to the students afterwards so everyone has easy access. So just relatedly, to speak about another sort of public food program, one student asks, I know that public elementary schools near me have contributed to distribute school and breakfast and lunch. With that said, are there national or state regulations or new policies that require public schools to do this, or is it just more of a sort of local government decision?
Yeah, so it is definitely definitely happening with local decision makers calling, you know, sort of local decision makers figuring out how to create models that work for their communities, and it's different depending on where you are, and school districts are using different strategies. What's complicated is that, as you can imagine, there are lots of rules and regulations about school food and how what you need to have in your school meal to be fully reimbursed by the federal government. And what we're hearing from some districts is that in the choices that they're making and the strategies that they're using and deploying to get food to families who need it most, they're actually not necessarily meeting all those requirements. And so they're actually not getting fully federally reimbursed. And so one school district that I just saw in this report on this recently was talking about how it looks like they've lost about $700,000 in federal reimbursement money already in because of this discrepancy between those regulations and what their meals look like in this new delivery model. And so that's another thing that advocates are working to relax those rules and regulations so that those meals that are going out to families can be fully reimbursed. And
Anna, one of our favorite homegrown companies that you know well, Revolution Foods, has jumped into this void and is serving millions of meals a week now in different school districts. And I read this afternoon from a note from the CEO that said they believe that this is going to continue. This will be a pattern that this kind of feeding of underserved people will continue beyond the school closures and potentially become a fixture in communities, which is a potential silver lining.
Yeah, and I mean, I think it speaks to this interesting point about policy and business and how we respond in crisis. I think, some of the silver lining has been seeing the way that decisions are made with maybe a little bit more focus on just people's humanity and also what works practically and quickest. And so that can be sort of uplifting and exciting as a model for how we make decisions as businesses and governments going forward. Mm-hmm. And just to speak a little bit more to this question of kind of local versus state federal policy, be curious, it's a bit of a loaded question, but in terms of, you know, we have this presidential election coming up, which feels sort of equally surreal to the crisis. And obviously the primary has already been sort of significantly affected by the crisis. And so I'd be curious to hear like the types of policy interventions that you would hope to see in the coming months and then maybe after the November election. What are your thoughts on kind of the most powerful levers? Do we have faith that a federal government run by either potential candidate could get to those policies you're interested in? Or do you imagine state and local policy is going to be more effective or kind of grassroots organizing efforts? Mm-hmm.
Well, I hope this doesn't sound like I'm evading your question to say all of the above. but I do believe it is all of the above because it is all essential, and it's essential that we not cede the federal government and in the sense that we give up on being able to make any federal policy reflect the values that we hold dear. So I think continuing to support big ideas like Medicare for All, big ideas like a Green New Deal, which in light of COVID-19, I mean, now is the time to actually have the government employing people and to do kind of a Green New Deal, you know, to do what they did in the New Deal, to really kickstart an economy and kickstart the kind of economic development that we know we need in the climate crisis. I think it's still an opportunity to have those radical calls for debt cancellation, for housing for all, to continue to be calling for the things that we know we need and that COVID-19 is making so clear. I mean, no one, no, you know, no nurse or doctor should be burdened by medical school debt right now. No student who's in the position that all of you are in, sheltered in place, doing online classes, should come out of this with student debt. None of you that are potentially struggling to pay your rent should worry about being evicted because you don't have the same income you did 5 weeks ago or 6 weeks ago. So I think that that level of conversation needs to happen. And at the same time, of course, really working at the local level to be continuing to engage people in policy change so that they can really feel themselves. Because I think what happens with people getting disillusioned by national politics is that they don't actually feel like they're seeing any benefits to a policy fight, win or lose. So for instance, here in the state of California, one of the bright spots for me in the past several weeks has been this huge win by a group called Schools and Communities First, which is putting a proposition on California's ballot in the fall, which would be the first time in 40 years that we would have a proposition to reform a terrible draconian property tax measure called Prop 13. Passed 40 years ago, and thanks to Prop 13, we tanked California schools and the funding for schools that come from property taxes, and pushed California school funding to down toward the bottom 50, almost 50th in the states. And what this measure would do would actually reform it so that commercial properties, businesses, not small businesses, but big businesses actually have to pay their real fair market value for their properties, and could potentially bring into the California economy between $11 and $12 billion a year, half of it going to schools and half of it going to communities for local governments to maybe put toward things like urban farming or, you know, other food systems reforms. And so that they just announced last week that they secured 1.7 million signatures, the largest number of signatures ever secured for a petition drive, putting it on the ballot in the fall. And it's a great example of, like, that took real, real grassroots organizing across the state. And if it were to pass, that would really affect people's lives in a really demonstrable way. So I think it's all of the above for sure.
Great, thank you. And thanks for giving some specific examples. I think that makes it a little more tangible. And so we're gonna transition somewhat soon to breakout groups, but I guess just to kind of wrap up this conversation and move a little bit more to solutions, I think this question of funding is really interesting, and it kind of touches on a couple student questions I'm seeing here just to tie them together. One student asks, what do we see as a just alternative to our current reliance on low-wage migrant farm workers? And I imagine there's part of that question of, like, restaurants being on the margin and how that's affordable. And then another student asked, how can we sort of, like, manifest or realize the importance of localized food systems? And so something, yeah, I think a lot about from a funding perspective is, or from a policy perspective, is funding to whatever, expand public programs, pay people a fair wage. And so you listed one example just now of a policy solution for funding. The soda tax has been floated mm-hmm. in California as one potential solution, but if you have any ideas about shifting our economic structure a bit.
Yeah. I mean, I think there are so many creative revenue models. I've been a huge supporter and advocate for sugary drinks taxes. They've proven to be really effective from a public health perspective, but also for generating revenue. The city of Seattle is one of the few cities that has passed a sugary drinks tax in the U.S. And interestingly, in the wake of COVID-19, the community advisory council that's helping to direct the revenue from the sugary drinks tax has been looking at how can you take some of that revenue and actually put it to things like increasing the resources that schools have for their school meal program, for instance. But ultimately, I mean, I think that there's lots of creative revenue possibilities. I think we should not be afraid of things like, you know, soda taxes. But ultimately what we need is really deep reforms to our tax structure. I mean, corporate taxes and taxes on the wealthy are at a lower percentage than they've ever been. And that even if we went back to, say, the levels that they were a few decades ago, we would have so much more public dollars to work with. And so COVID-19 is hitting at a moment where for decades we have had this sort of ideological drumbeat that big government is bad, that, you know, government can do no good, that the private sector is the answer. And at the same time, we've had a drumbeat of tax reform policies that have diminished the amount of money that governments have to work with in service of the public good. So you have this sort of vicious cycle where as government gets increasingly underfunded because we have less tax dollars coming in, government functions less well, and you actually aren't able to do all the things and provide the public services that we really, really need. And so it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. And so I think there is a moment with COVID-19 where it is becoming clearer, maybe to some people who had sort of bought into that ideology that what is government good for, to really see that there is such a value to the public sector, that we need a strong public sector, that we need a strong government to be able to step in times of crisis, and also to create the resiliency in our economy so that a crisis like this would never again cripple us the way it is now. And so, you know, not to go too high level on us, but I mean, I really think that unless you're having a conversation about kind of that level of tax reform, you would never be able to, even with these creative, powerful, let's advocate for them tax measures, you'd never be able to make up for that loss in public revenue.
Thanks for that. Yeah. And I'll just highlight for the students, we have some great faculty here at Berkeley that are doing work on these issues. So Gabrielle Zuckman and Emmanuel Zayas are two professors in the economics department who are looking at really radical shifts to the tax code. And there's a couple interesting New York Times articles about their work before this crisis, and then also an op-ed about how they've compared responses in other countries to the US and how that impacts people's livelihoods, especially low-wage workers. And then Amy Lerman over the Public Policy School is studying this issue of the reputation of government, even not just among people that we maybe associate that as a conservative thing, but actually there's a pretty widespread sense of distrust in the government's ability to take care of people. And so that's, both of these issues are seem really critical, and think how the government reacts during this time of crisis will have an impact.
Yeah. And, you know, and I think it's also, it's hard, you know, we're, this is the air in which we breathe. Like maybe some of you live abroad and are just, you know, just come to the US for a year or two and you're seeing this country with fresh eyes. But you know, I just was talking with one of my sisters who lives in South Korea right now, and she was talking about what the government of South Korea is doing, how they sent a care package to every single South Korean that had like a pep talk letter, like, we're going to get through this, had a mask, had a thermometer, you know, sort of told you what you need to know, how they have had really clear policies and clear language about social distancing that's been nationwide, how they have, she said, even on your Google Maps in South Korea, when you open up your Google Map, you can see your nearest pharmacy. And I think she even said it like lists how many masks are available there. You can go to the pharmacy and you show them your ID. And depending on how old you are, I think there's a certain number of masks you can get allocated every day. And you know, I think that, of course, there's so many other governments we can look to that are taking a different path than we have here. And I think there's local governments and state governments that are taking a different path than the national government. So I think it's just that, again, kind of to open our minds to the creative possibilities of what a really strong, democratic, community accountable government could be like for us and the good it could bring.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, I think that's another reason why as students, we kind of need to be thinking in a global sense.
Yeah.
So much to learn from what other people are doing. So I want to turn it over to Will to introduce the breakout activity. I will say we have a number of students in the chat suggesting that you run for office. So
I'll tell that to my husband.
An opportunity to discuss in the breakout room. But we do also have some students asking questions about, you know, obviously we're all here at Berkeley. It can be a bit of a bubble. So I think let's in our chat rooms definitely think about how do we talk about these reforms in places maybe where these ideas seem much more radical.
Yeah. And just to say, for those of you who might not stay through the duration, you can connect with me, my coworkers at realfoodmedia.org. We have a number of resources. We have a Real Food Reads podcast that focuses on food books, and we're about to launch a new podcast called Foodtopias that will be my team in conversation with leaders around the country that are exploring these questions. You know, how do we take this moment to actually build the food system that we want and need? So please sign up for our newsletter and reach out to me and my team at Real Food Media if you have any further questions or want to get connected.
Thanks, Anna. That's so inspiring and powerful. And you're going to stay with us. I know you're going to go check on your daughters, but you're going to come back after we do the breakout. What we're going to do is break out into groups of four people, and we're going to encourage you to have a discussion about threats and opportunities. And let me just share a little instruction that I created for you so you get a little idea what's going to happen. So we're going to try something brand new. You know, we're always experimenting here with Zoom and trying to explore the dimensions of this. We're bringing our mindset of play to bear tonight. So what you're going to do, we're going to break you out into groups of four. You're going to introduce yourselves. Be sure your video and your audio are on. One person should volunteer to be the scribe, and that person needs to be a Berkeley student. So it's likely that you're going to be in a group that has Berkeley students and members of the community, but the Berkeley student needs to be the scribe. I am going to post a link to the chat that is going to give you a slide template, which you are going to be able to download and open. You're going to want to copy that template and rename it. You can give your group a name. And then what you want to do is generate and record ideas around threats and opportunities and actions. And Anna and Fiona highlighted a lot of ideas around policy tonight. And hopefully we'll also generate ideas and actions around from other communities as well, like perhaps technology or education or business or medicine or health. So your the scope of what you discuss in your group can be wide-ranging and hopefully multidisciplinary. So with that, now I'm going to attempt to share this template with you, if I can get to it. This is the threats and opportunities template, and I am going to get the link. You're going to see it live, and I am going to get the link here, and then I'm going to try to, I'm doing all this live, so bear with me. I'm going to go back. Uh-oh, it's asking me to go back to sign it. That's not right. Let's see if I can stop sharing my screen. Okay, that's good. Let me type the chat in here. Tell me if you can see that chat. Can you see it, Fiona? Did it come up? You can copy. Okay, good. Connie sees it. You can copy that. Try to copy that. And now what I'm going to do is put you into breakout groups. And so one of you is going to choose to be the scribe. And we're going to give you about 10 minutes, 10 to 12 minutes for the breakout. Please engage, have fun, enjoy this. This is a really interesting part. You might meet somebody you never knew before. And so we'll do the breakout room, and then we'll come back. We'll have Anna for a little bit more. We'll take attendance. And we'll wrap up and, people are saying they can't copy it. All right, let me try that again. Hold on. Let's see, anyone can copy? Copied, I'm gonna, let me try it to everyone again. Okay, some of our students are giving great direction. Right click, then services, then open URL as URL. Okay, good. Thank you. All right, now I'm going to go back to our breakouts. Oh, and apologies to any of you that had trouble logging in tonight. Zoom changes every week, and we really appreciate your patience with that. We're really learning as we go. Okay, so here we go.
Sorry, we're gonna Professor, we still cannot copy the link, though.
We're going to have 44 breakout rooms now.
Hey, Will, I don't think people are still able.
Hey, Will. I'm sending this link to a couple of the people that had to call in.
Sure.
Yeah, it doesn't seem to copy and paste outside.
Yeah, it may be only open to Berkeley. So the person in the breakout room that's going to be the scribe needs to be a Berkeley person. So they're the only person that needs to complete the sheet.
Right. Yeah, but I cannot copy it and go to it from here either.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Can you send it out as a message to them?
I don't know how I
would. I'm so sorry to interrupt. I got booted out of my breakout room because I had to go
into
settings so that my video was on. And
oh, I'm going to assign.
No, it's just me.
If you go down to the bottom of your Zoom, to the toolbar, there's breakout rooms, and you can rejoin whatever group that you you were originally in.
Oh, okay. Yes, I'm sorry. We left our room as well because we couldn't copy the link. So you will be sending the link right now to everyone again?
I'm going to put you in a room. How's that?
Okay, yeah, just our problem was that no one from our group were able to, like, get access to the link.
Oh, okay.
Right.
So all of us came here, and we cannot copy, because when we're trying to copy, it does not copy, and when we try to click,
it doesn't. Yeah, it's not letting us share it with non-Berkeley people. Let me see what I can do.
I'm a Berkeley person, and I'm not getting it either.
Yeah, the same with me.
Send it maybe via email? And just broadcast to them that you're sending it out as a mass email.
Where would I send it, though? Let's see.
Just copy the link and email it to your students.
I can't. I don't have a way. Well,
or
I can
B post courses.
B courses. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I guess I could
do that. Yeah. Okay. I'll go. And you can message them in your breakout room saying, "I copied and pasted the link."
Okay.
In
B courses. I will try to do that.
Sure. And if any of you have come out of your room, you can rejoin your room by pressing on the breakout rooms on the toolbar at the bottom and re-enter those rooms. There are a few people on a phone, though, just to let you know.
I'm going to try to make a new announcement.
Okay.
Threats, opportunity. Can you put on chat that I sent it to B-Courses? Oh,
yes, you can. Just go into your breakout room window that you originally have. Click on the breakout room. And at the bottom of it, it says broadcast message to all. I would do it more than once because it's only a few seconds that it broadcasts it.
Okay.
But yes. Mm-hmm. Will is sending everyone the link. If you guys can just hang on a moment and go back into your breakout rooms. If you're having trouble, please let us know.
Okay, well, people seem to be in a lot of rooms here.
Yeah. They're finding things to talk about.
Some people have bounced out of rooms. Is there... I wonder...
You can ask them.
Are you a co-host, Aria?
Yeah, you can, but I cannot effectively work your breakout rooms. You can make me a host if you would like. However, they can go back into their breakout rooms by just clicking on their Zoom toolbar, pressing on the breakout room. press clicking on breakout room and then join.
If I make you the host until, and you hand it back to me in about 8 minutes or so.
Sure, of course.
Thank you.
How many people did you want per room?
Like 3 to 4.
Okay.
I'm going to send you
Sure. If you have not received an invitation, please let me know. Okay, Leanne, hang on just a moment. Let me find you. And I will send you a new invitation. Man, can you look and see which room you were in for me? Okay. Can you let me know that as well, Andrea? It was about 7:30.
Yeah.
Down at the bottom of your toolbar, you should be able to see breakout room.
It's I don't know because you're the host.
Yeah, you weren't in a breakout room. They were. Yeah. So which room does it tell you to join? Sorry. Okay, great. Thank you so much. I can move you out of there then. It's hard to move people around when I don't know where they're at. Right. So I've given you a new invitation. Leanne, can you tell me which breakout room you were in? Ah, I see you. Okay, I'm going to move you to a different breakout room. Let's go here. I've sent you a new one, Leanne. Okay, everyone else that's here was non-responsive, Will.
Thank you.
Oh, Ross, you're responsive. Let me see. It's okay. Are you on your phone, Ross? Okay. Can you click on breakout room? Okay. Let me see if I can add you. And then we can, yep, I found you. So I'm going to add you to a room right now. There you go. He got out. Great. And how much longer did you want the rooms to be open?
Why don't we go if maybe, well, actually, do you want to just send me back the host and then I'll
sure.
In the of course. Button? Yeah.
And yeah. Then, all right. I'm assigning you back as host.
I got it. Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm.
Because this way I can kind of see what people are doing and drop into the rooms too.
Yes. So much fun. Did we begin to close? Yes. Okay, great.
Fantastic, everyone. Thank you for trying out that experiment. And it looks like we've gotten a lot of good contributions of the Google Docs. And Fiona and I will do our best to check those out. And I don't know if we're going to be able to compile them or what we can do with them, but it would be nice if we were able to figure out how we could share all of those with you. So we really appreciate that. And we're eager to see the really the productive output from 175 people who participated in the breakout. So thank you very much for that. I'm going to make a couple of quick announcements. I'm going to take attendance, and then I'm going to give it back to Fiona and Anna. So if you have a few more questions, you can also post those to chat now. In my family, we actually have a saying that goes, finish strong. Whatever you start out to do, you try to finish strong. And that's what we're going to try to do with Edible Ed. And I'm really delighted to let you know that next week, we're going to have a special guest named Jose Andres. He was recently on the cover of Time magazine. We've actually been inviting him for several years to campus, and he was able to agree to that this year. And unfortunately, his visit will be disrupted, but he has generously agreed to be with us next week live to talk to you. And we're going to focus on social entrepreneurship, leadership, organization. We're going to try to really understand how Jose has been so effective at really organizing systems of great impact to feed the world in need. I'm reading this book that talks all about his response and all of the people that worked with him on Hurricane Maria. So if you want to check out either of these books, this is his new cookbook, which is amazing. And this is his book about Hurricane Maria. So we'll be in conversation. And also Alice Waters will be joining us next week. And next week's class is also going to be a Haas Dean speaker series. So Dean Ann Harrison is going to join us for that class as well. And we're actually going to open it up to, I believe, the bigger Zoom room. So we may have up to 500 people. So spread the word. We'll be sending out the registration information a little earlier than last week, and our Eventbrite list will be a little bit larger. Also, for the remaining classes, following Jose, we have a class focused on innovation and entrepreneurship, and we're going to have three amazing leaders of early stage food companies that you have requested earlier in the semester. And that class is being organized by one of your graduate teaching assistants, Eva Gerfain. And then to end our semester together, I'm really delighted to confirm and let you know that the one and only Michael Pollan will be with us to close up our class. So I'm really excited about our three final classes. Let's do a quick poll for attendance. Students, just answer this really quickly. Are you here tonight? This will generate a report that will let us give you credit for being here. Thanks for being so responsive to this. I see so many of you are responding right away. We really appreciate that. And now I'm going to turn it back over to, I'm going to leave this poll open just for a few minutes in case people are just staggered a little bit. But I'm going to turn it back over to Fiona and Anna.
Thanks, Will. Great. So we have about 10 minutes left. So if anyone has any additional questions that they want to share in the chat, or I think especially speaking of ending on a strong note, if you have any kind of positive ideas for action that came out of your conversation, I'd love to hear that. And I could even unmute your video if you want to share that rather than just put it in the chat. While we're waiting for folks to post in there, Anna, one question I wanted to address, which we didn't get to talk to talk about as much about before the breakout was kind of how do we speak across different cultural boundaries, geographical boundaries, and kind of make these ideas that you're talking about maybe more palatable to a larger swath of people in the U.S.
Mm-hmm. Great question, and I saw that come up in the chat room before. I think that there's a couple ways that I answer that question. I mean, I think first, one of the challenges of this moment is how much our media landscape has fractured over the past decade or more. One of the areas of our work at Real Food Media has been to really expose misinformation in news and media about food and how much the food industry actually shapes a lot of what we see and hear as news and as unbiased information. And a few years ago, we wrote a report called Spinning Food, which talks about how the food industry is the various ways that they are kind of surreptitiously shaping the story of food. And we are in the process of turning that into an updated report. And in the process of reporting out the sort of spinning food 2.0, it struck me just in the 5 years or 4 years since we reported out the last one, how many fewer journalists are working, how many fewer newspapers we have, what this bifurcation of our media landscape means for us to be able to communicate about something like the science and the facts of COVID-19. So I would first say that that's a huge part of our struggle, and that we exist so much more in these filter bubbles of our Twitter feed or our Facebook feed and distrust, and that there's been this real distrust of kind of mainstream media, or as Donald Trump calls it, lamestream media. But to this other question, which is, I saw in the chat, somebody asked, you know, are we just talking to the choir or speaking to the choir. And there's a couple ways I think of that, and this might be super cheesy, so bear with me. But one of the things that strikes me is that I actually feel like there is a real value and importance to reaching the choir. And the choir, by the way, is not small. We're not talking about a small group of people. We're talking actually about quite a significant portion of the population that actually shares these values of that I mentioned at the top of my talk about wanting a food system that actually helps and respects workers and that is actually contributing to our health and that isn't causing climate change. Those are values that are actually really shared by a lot of people. But very much I acknowledge that a lot of, and possibly even in this class, you know, that you all might see yourselves as part of the choir. But like I said, I think it's important to speak to the choir for a couple reasons. And again, bear with me on the cheesy metaphor. But first, I think it's important for any choir to know the lyrics to the song. So all the education that you guys are getting in this class is essential. Like, it doesn't matter if you kind of care about something passionately. If you don't understand the issue, if you don't understand what's at stake, if you don't understand the facts and the science, that kind of energy and activism doesn't have the same grounding. So first, the choir needs to learn the lyrics to the song. Secondly, I think there's a real power in the choir learning to speak together. So again, one of the things that we've been doing for years at Real Food Media is working with partners, activists, advocates in the field to really work on what's called narrative change. So how do you actually, as a network, like the Food Chain Workers Alliance, how do you get those worker member organizations to actually speak in a unified voice that is resonant across these member organizations to then call for really strong labor protections, for instance? That's really teaching the choir to sing together. And then the final thing of this cheesy metaphor that I would add is that there is a real benefit to the choir even realizing that the choir exists. You know, I think part of our despair sometimes has felt, is in feeling like we're the only ones that feel a certain way or the only ones that care about something. And so part of connecting with a choir is really feeling that sense that you're not alone in your in the passionate interests that you have or the fact that you all care to take a class like edible education. So I think that, you know, those are just some of the ways that I think about actually there being a real value in connecting as a choir, again, with the caveat that I know it's a cheesy metaphor.
I love it. It's great. So yeah, and I think something that has been brought up a lot since sort of like the increasing isolation between different thought bubbles in the US and the proliferation of social media and media as a place to kind of extend those those walls between people. People in the food movement often talk about the value of getting together and eating with others, which right now is obviously limited its capacity. But I was going to share one sort of like hopeful thing that I have been seeing recently that has lifted my spirits, which is on sometimes like an evening walk around my neighborhood in Berkeley. There's a lot of lights on. People are in their houses and eating together at the table, which is something we don't always get to do as much in the modern world. So I think that's got me thinking about sort of ways that people might be connecting in a slower way with the people around them to discuss these issues in more depth, as opposed to sort of only in these more combative ways. And so and I'll let you finish off. Someone had a question in the chat box that was just about what real food media does overall, and I want to give you the chance to just pitch that to the class before you go. So maybe with the 5 minutes remaining, if you want to, if there's any like positive silver linings you've seen, like my food experience, maybe share that with the class, although no pressure. And then if you want to close this out with just a little sum up of what real food does, and then I'll send the link out to the class afterwards.
Great. Yeah. So Real Food Media, it is a small organization, small but mighty. I have myself and three other folks on the team. And what we do is really try to help amplify the solution stories that are out there in terms of food systems change, as well as to really elevate a lot of the issues and critical concerns that we have about our industrial food system. So we do that in a number of ways. We've ran for many years a international short films competition to kind of showcase the positive stories and the critique. We do a lot of other writing and public speaking, and then do kind of critical analysis work around media. And I mentioned the Spinning Food Report. But the kind of second category of work that we do is really in partnership with advocates on the ground to help them develop strong communication strategy. And our longest standing partnership, and the one that occupies most of my team's time, is working on a really powerful, as we see it, policy around food procurement called the Good Food Purchasing Program. You might have heard about it in this class before, but it was a program that was started in 2012 in Los Angeles to look at the billions of dollars that schools and universities spend across the country every year, and to explore the development of a policy that would enable city governments and school districts to actually purchase food through a values lens, not just choosing cheapest food suppliers. And the program passed in 2012 and has really shown across Los Angeles and now many cities just how much it has the power to change food supply chains. So Real Food Media is kind of the communication strategy leg of this procurement policy stool. We work really closely with a group called the Center for Good Food Purchasing, which is the kind of policy analysis house and the kind of policy workhorse. And then our third partner is the Food Chain Workers Alliance, and they're kind of that organizing leg. So they're really about helping to build those strong coalitions on the ground. And what excites me so much about this policy and why we've been so involved as a team is because it's a policy that really requires that you bring a systems approach to procurement, and that you look at intersecting values and not sort of lifting up one value over the other. And what I mean by that is the policy looks at food purchasing through the lens of the environment, human health, worker welfare, animal well-being, and local economic development, and unites all those values and says they're all important and they all need to be at the table. And so as an organizing strategy, it brings workers to the table, it brings animal rights activists to the table, it brings public health advocates and many more to the table, building really strong coalitions and also really helping to create, helping to push for and advocate for policies that we've seen really make a huge difference. So we've been working for several years now, and now we have helped to pass the policy in a number of cities across the country that collectively spend about $1 billion on food purchases annually. Now, does all that food go to, you know, our dream food supply chain? No, but it means that it's part of a policy system that can hopefully move over the years toward toward procurement that looks more like a reflection of our values. So that's some of what we do, but please check out our work at Real Food Media. And sorry, I'm a little distracted. My dog came into the office and he's like wanting me to play with him.
Perfect timing.
What's that?
Perfect timing.
Exactly. But yeah, so take a look at Real Food Media, and we put out a monthly newsletter that has kind of highlights from partners across the country on news highlights and other work that is happening. And like I said, we have a monthly podcast as well.
Anna, thank you so much. It's just been fantastic to have you here, and you covered so much great content for us. And Fiona, thank you so much for hosting us tonight and leading really a fascinating conversation. And I'm just thrilled that we get to at least see each other this way each week and continue this important learning experience together. So wish everybody a good evening, another safe week of safe social distancing, masks, and good eating. So take care. And thanks again, Anna.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Great to see your faces.
Thanks, Anna.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Good night.